You have a lot of interest. How will you connect them into a great job?
As Director of Human Health at the Cleveland Museum of Natural History, Dr. Linda Spurlock's job is to educate the public through exhibits, programming, and health education classes. But from time to time, she's asked to utilize her unique scientific training as a biological anthropologist and forensic artist to help the police department identify the remains of a murder victim.
Biological anthropologists would decide if it was male or female, any ethnic clues, how old, how tall, and then a sketch artist or a forensic sculptor would then try to put a face on the skull. So I will create a face that pretty much looks like that person, at least enough for friends and relatives to identify.
Every human skull shares similar characteristics, but if studied carefully, each will reveal its own unique features. To demonstrate this, Dr. Spurlock handpicked two skulls from the Natural History Museum's extensive human bone collection. She then took us through the process of creating two separate sketches.
The first thing we do when we're getting ready to reconstruct a face on an unidentified person is to glue the lower jaw onto its anatomical position.
Next, pieces of mechanical erasers are cut to size and glued on. These tissue depth markers indicate how far out the skin extended in life. Next, careful measurements are made to determine the very specific characteristics of each skull. Then, two photos are taken, one from the front and another from the side, called a profile. These are then photocopied and taped to firm paper. Dr. Spurlock then draws the outline of the face based on the tissue depth markers. Utilizing her knowledge of the human body, she then draws in nostrils, eyeballs, and on the profile, she sketches out the mouth and ears. Next, she adds hair, some shading, and fills in some of the features based once again on the unique qualities of each skull. So how'd the sketches turn out? Let's start with the first woman, who died in her late 20s.
This individual had a lot of tooth loss, especially in her molar area, which would have made her face sag in. So that's why the deep shadows here. The other woman was 19 or 20. She had plenty of teeth. So she has a good fullness of her lips. She's not caved in here. This woman just by nature had a wider nose with a more prominent tip and more prominent in through here. You can especially see this in the profile. Very strong jaw, very strong nose. Two very different white women.
So now you've got your face, that's it. You've got a positive ID, right? Well, not quite.
I could do the best sketch in the world. It could look exactly like the missing person. That's not a positive ID. Only things like fingerprints, DNA, those kind of things give a positive ID.
Some of the same techniques used in forensic sketching are also used to create a three-dimensional forensic sculpture of an unidentified person. While Dr. Spurlock has used her talents and skills to do this, she actually prefers recreating the likenesses of people who lived thousands of years ago. In 2009, she created sculptures of two ancient ancestors that were used in the museum's Making Faces exhibit.
I did a Neanderthal boy, maybe about 8 to 12 year olds, and then I also did a Inca person. So I bought a copy of a skull that had the artificial cranial deformation and also had a healed wound from prehistoric brain surgery.
Since her childhood, Dr. Spurlock has always been interested in science, and she decided early on to find a career that would help her satisfy her deep curiosity about the world.
At a certain point in my career, I was studying a lot of anthropology, and I got very, very interested in skeletons. And my advisor at my New York school said, "Oh, you really want to go to Kent State to study skeletal biology. And they have a great program at Kent State where not only do you take courses in the anthropology department, but you also take courses at the local medical school."
Beside her love for science, Dr. Spurlock is a talented artist. She enjoyed both so much that she blended the two into a rewarding career.
So many different threads come together to make fabulous careers. So you don't know until you try. And it's good to research just what's out there and try a few things because you might be good at things you have no clue that you were good at.